As a YouTuber, video editor, photographer, aspiring voiceover artist, data hoarder, and general content creator, I use a lot of hard drive space. A lot of space. Video footage of ongoing projects, archived video footage of important projects, family photos, professional photos, raw waves of my voice recordings, movies, TV shows, terabytes upon terabytes of data. Following me filling pretty much every drive I had earlier this year, my main YouTube storage array, a foolish leftover RAID 0 array, crashed. I lost a ton of footage, about a month or two worth of work, along with about a month of downtime trying to fix everything and get set back up, really screwed over my workflow for this year. It was time for an upgrade. Enter part one of me getting serious about my file storage, my QNAP TS-451A. This thing is a boss. QNAP reached out and offered to send it over for review, so I went ahead and grabbed some refurbished 2 terabyte drives from Newegg on eBay. I loaded it up in a basic JBOD array, copied over some files, and fell in love with the performance. So much so that I wound up deleting some of the footage that I had stored on the device just in time for my unit to die. The fourth drive slot kept dropping out, sending the unit into a very loud beeping and continuously unmounting and remounting my array. QNAP quickly replaced my unit and the new one has worked perfectly ever since, so I'll write that up to bad luck, but still worth noting that this happened. And just a reminder to keep a backup of your data, which you should be doing anyway, because that's what normal people do. I did have a backup of this data, but that was actually my backup, so it was a close call. The TS-451A, these NAS units always have such lovely names, features a dual-core Intel Celeron CPU with a base clock of 1.6 GHz and 2 GB or 4 GB of RAM. My unit has 4 GB. Taking a tour of the front, we have indicator LEDs for just about everything. A SD card slot, a power button, a button to automatically copy footage from the SD card slot, something that I'd use more if I didn't need all of the storage on the unit for archives already, although I'm reworking that at the moment. I'll work on those during future upgrade videos, and a USB 3.0 port for connecting external hard drives. Below that, there's also a micro USB female end as well for their direct access connectivity. More on that later. We are also greeted with the 4 drive bays. These are easy to install and remove, and overall setup was a breeze. The sides and top are barren, with the bottom containing 4 great rubber feet. Around back, we have a lot of fun stuff. There's a big but quiet cooling fan, Kensington lock, reset button, and maintenance port. Oh wait, that's not the fun stuff. There's 2 gigabit Ethernet ports, which can come in quite handy for the plethora of features available to this thing. HDMI video out, 3.5 millimeter audio out and audio in, and 2 more USB 3.0 ports, and the DC power input. That's a lot of I/O for this thing. Compared to the little single drive WD NAS units I used to use, this thing is baller and basically a computer. Oh yeah, and it has an IR receiver and a freaking remote control for the media server functionality of it. Not bad. Not to mention they just sent me over this mini wireless keyboard and touchpad for it that I haven't taken a look at yet, but will be in a future video. You can do a lot with this. It is basically a computer. Load it up with some hard drives, connect it to your network, and it's time to dive into the software. I want to go ahead and reiterate that this is essentially a computer. The capabilities and functionality built into the software are a lot more than I could ever fully explore in one video or just in my own usage of the device in the first place. I only have so much stored space to work with. The base software is a web-accessible OS that reminds me a lot of Android, intuitive and easy to use. Then you have a variety of different stations for using this device and a plethora of apps to download and install to do even more with the NAS. There are stations for streaming media over the network, to watch your movies and TV shows, stream music as an iTunes server, to back up computers in your home, to be a cloud drive accessible anywhere, manage surveillance cameras in your home, and even run virtual machines. It's pretty crazy. Diving into the App Center, there's email servers, real-time antivirus scanning, Google App Management, Azure Storage, the ever-popular Plex Media Server, a lot of syncing and backup apps, web server apps, WordPress, BitTorrent clients, games, more than I'll ever be able to explore. It's pretty crazy. When I first got the unit set up, I went nuts and installed everything I thought I could have fun with, but my current ongoing configuration is much more simple. I mainly just utilize the normal file system, accessible on my computers over the network. I have mounted network shares and network drives, the antivirus app for occasional scans, transmission for testing torrent downloads, JSTRIS, because Tetris, and then the Linux station for running VMs. I also use the Connect to Cloud Drive app, which allows me to easily connect to my Dropbox, Google Drive, and Amazon Cloud Drive to back up files. Since I use this NAS primarily as my footage archive and YouTube archive, this makes it relatively easy to back up my footage to Amazon. There's a couple of issues copying files sometimes, but it's very handy regardless. I'm still in the early stages of tinkering with the Linux station and virtualization station VM managers, and I want to do a dedicated video on them, but I will say it's quite easy to set up and manage VMs, and you can connect to them through your web browser or a VNC client. I'm really looking forward to utilizing them for future videos. This is where, to me, the dual Ethernet ports come in really handy. You can have one set of functions, like normal file copying, go over the first Ethernet port while your VM connects over the second and isn't impacted as much by network performance. I love it. I just wish I had more gigabit switches or a bigger one. Running a graphical OS like Elementary OS on virtualization station resulted in a fairly laggy experience, whereas running the Linux Manager app was much more responsive, and the display outputs over the device's HDMI, and you can hook a keyboard or mouse up and use it as a normal computer, which is pretty freaking neat. As far as Plex goes, I wasn't super worried about this, since I didn't have the extra space to put my media library on this specific device anyway, and already have a Plex server running on my video render server. Video on that soon. To test it though, I did set up a library of my YouTube upload original files and tried playing a few. It has zero problems streaming the original files over the network whatsoever, though it does eat up some CPU usage. Transcoding to a different resolution and compression, however, never really seemed to work. It just loads for a long time and then eventually tells me the video cannot be played. The Video Station app, on the other hand, does a lot better job with actually transcoding and playing the media, but it's a lot harder to use and set up. Frankly, it was much easier to just set up network shares and play the files over the network. But keep in mind, the Plex issues are often considered to be on the blame of Plex themselves, as there's so many different platforms that want a Plex app, they don't always do the best job of putting out an app in time for specific devices, and they don't always update them in time, and so on and so forth. Performance on the whole holds up well. Running Plex and a VM pegs the CPU usage in the 90% range, but things remain fairly responsive throughout. Playing a game like JS Tetris seems to have virtually no performance impact, which is pretty cool. There's a great little dashboard pop-up tool that shows you a lot of information. Uptime, disk status, connected users, network traffic, CPU and RAM usage, disk space allocation, and so on. I use it a lot. The unit remains fairly quiet too, especially hidden under my desk on top of my server tower. Also, did I mention that you could occupy all three USB 3.0 ports with external hard drives and share them over the network too? I can't get enough network storage, and that will come up in future storage upgrade videos. Lastly, I guess I would be remiss if I didn't discuss the main gimmicky feature for this NAS unit, the direct connection USB 3.0 connection on the device. Since this is a full computer and a NAS, the ability to hook it up as just an external hard drive can't really be done. Instead, the software for it creates a virtual network connection to the NAS over the USB bus. This is good if you can't set up a wired network connection for some reason, but it won't give you full USB 3.0 speeds like a normal wired external hard drive. This isn't something I'm ever really going to use, so I will instead point you to a video by Lon Seidman, who reviewed the 2-bay model of this device and showed just how the did a good job of showing how the functionality worked. On the whole, I'm very happy with this NAS. My only limitations are my upload speed for backing up files and my financial ability to buy bigger and bigger hard drives for it. This kind of mass storage I need is way too expensive for my wallet, whereas just a few terabytes for an average home user or enthusiast is totally affordable. The problem then comes from the price of the device itself, almost $500 from what I'm seeing online. That's quite expensive for something that you have to populate with hard drives, at least to me. It's not far from the normal market, but it still bothers me. NAS units are at this weird point where the whole setup is too expensive for the average user, despite being a very useful home tool for just about anyone. They do have expansion bays that you can hook up to it as well, which I hope I can look into at some point. This concludes part one of my storage upgrade series and my review of the QNAP TS-451A NAS. My important footage archive and YouTube upload archive both rest comfortably within the 8 terabytes I loaded into the NAS, and it's backing up to Amazon Cloud Drive almost constantly. I'm pretty happy with it, and maybe you will be too. If you enjoyed this video, smash the like button, get subscribed for more awesome tech videos, and I will see you next time.